Okay, so let's take climate change. And I was talking about climate change with this chap, and he said, yes, but in 1984 it was warmer than it is this year. I don't know if you get it, but this is this, you call it denial, but this is actually something that's basically very biological. Have you ever had a fight with your husband?
Where is he? He's downstairs still. Bless
yeah, yeah, so you can talk, further.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
I think one of the most important things for couples to figure out is how to fight.
Well, I haven't figured that one out yet. No, but my question is more based on maybe the people in the public might recognize this as well. When you're having a fight with your partner, it's about you being right, isn't it?
No.
Just checking?
No.
Generally? Or it's about the other one who wants to be right, correct? Okay, and what is the general strategy why an argument escalates? Oh, wait a minute.
Someone doesn't agree with me.
Exactly. So I keep bringing new arguments to prove that I'm right. Okay, why doesn't this work? The answer is it is in our own biology. It's very simple. Everything that happens in the world around us comes into our brain via our senses and first comes past the midbrain, the reptile brain, some people call it, the limbic system. And this is where emotions are generated, regulated, everything. So long before it's even got into your brain, the big brain, the neocortex, where you think about things logically, you already have the emotion. Now, if somebody is telling you you are wrong, what's the first emotion that's going to come up? What do you think?
Anger.
Well, not anger even. Anger is second. The first one is anxiety. Mm. And that's the word you wanted me to focus on, wasn't it? So what happens in our body when anxiety hits in?
It has a feeling of a higher energy, a bit more uncontrollable. Inside you, maybe in here, sort of feels a little bit like you can't hold as much in your bucket.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fight, flight, freeze mode, yes. Yes, you know, people sometimes forget about freeze. It's a very important one. Okay. The basis of this is that in your biology, what happens is that your limbic system has seen, here comes a threat. And guess what? Your limbic system doesn't like that. Why? Because your limbic system is there to make sure you survive. So your limbic system kicks in another couple of systems. One of them is to put all processes that are in your body that aren't necessary right now on a lower key. Your digestive system, it's fine if it's off for an hour or two. Doesn't matter. Your immune system, ditto. Your immune system can be off for 3 hours. Nothing's the matter. It will catch up afterward. And it also switches off your neocortex. Oops, they didn't teach us that one, did they? Because when you are in a survival state of mind, the only thing you need to do is act quickly. And that's all pre-programmed. You don't have to think about that. That's pre-programmed. Fight, flight, freeze. Somebody, okay, got it. So if we are busy trying to get people to change their behavior on the basis of anxiety, I'm afraid we've lost it. We're only going to get defensive reactions. Begs the question, how the hell do we do it?
I totally agree. And I think that's forget even about the word climate. Anxiety moves people into a scarcity mindset, and you're responding immediately and quickly, and I see that across the board. I don't mean to keep bringing it back to executives, but I want to link it up to how people operate in the workplace.
Mm-hmm.
Because the word toxic is thrown about more mm-hmm. often than not these days. And it's
that's
not
my work, toxic leadership.
That's exactly. And it's not a generational thing. It's not something millennials or Gen Z have come
nope.
up with. I see it at the most senior levels. I see it with people who've just joined the company.
Yeah.
So the system isn't working. And
sure.
anxiety is one portion of it. So say, and with the instability that comes with the chaotic world that we live right now,
mm-hmm.
And people are shrinking and thinking more from a scarcity mindset perspective.
Sure.
What is your go-to advice for people? Because I think we had a talk about this. This is not an age thing.
No, it's not an age thing.
It's for
no.
anyone who is at work no. right now.
Because my clients come from all generations. I have absolutely everything that comes, who are often the victims of toxic leadership. Perhaps that's a good way to draw a parallel. If I go to an organization, because organizations send their clients to me, eh? They pay me to look after their clients. And if I go back to them and say, hey, could it be you have a toxic work environment here? What do you think I'm going to get as answer? Anybody have a clue? This. You've got to be joking. We don't have a toxic work environment. Okay, so how does this work? It works on several levels simultaneously. Somebody who is a toxic leader has friends upstairs. They always seem like the big performers. They're not. They're stealing all the performance from people below them. So that's one aspect. The other aspect has got to do, again, with anxiety. If I'm coming you to tell you, your organization, there might be something wrong there, I'm threatening you. You're not going to listen. You're going to go on the defensive. When we're talking about scarcity, what are we going to default to? To what we know. When we're talking scarcity, we are very scared of new things. We're still talking about anxiety. So how do we get out of the anxiety mindset? It's really the challenge I believe we're up mm-hmm. for.